Long ago, in a faraway land, there was a prosperous kingdom ruled by a young emperor.
Oh, yeah!
Boom, baby!
He had a serious attitude.
You threw off my groove!
I'm sorry, but you've thrown off the emperor's groove.
Sorry!
An evil advisor.
By the way, you're fired.
I'll take over and rule the empire.
And one major problem.
I'll just poison him with this.
Hey, Croc, can you top me off, pal? Be a friend?
A llama? He's supposed to be dead!
Yeah, weird.
Take him out of town and finish the job!
Now, his only hope is a humble peasant.
Demon llama!
Demon llama? Where? You kidnapped me!
Why would I kidnap a llama?
You're the criminal mastermind, not me.
What?
Tell me Cusco's dead.
Ow!
Well, he's not as dead as we would have hoped.
No, break.
Why did I risk my life for a selfish brat like you?
Now I feel really bad. Bad llama.
This holiday season, the Emperor's got a new look. A new partner.
We're gonna have to work together to get out of this.
You know, it's a good thing you're not a big fat guy, or this would be really difficult.
And a brand new groove. Disney Pictures presents The Emperor's New Groove.
Uh-oh.
Don't tell me. We're about to go over a huge waterfall.
Yep.
Sharp rocks at the bottom?
Most likely.
Bring it on. Booyah!
December 2000 in theaters everywhere.
One and all to a very special guest choice episode of Escape from Walt Disney, the podcast where we review movies, TV shows, and short films available on the Disney Plus streaming service, usually chosen completely at random. I am your host, Tony Goldmark, joining us today via Zoom all the way from Burbank, California, Kyle Carrozza.
It's a good thing I'm not a big fat guy or else this would be really difficult.
All the way from Burbank, California, Lindsay Smith.
Hi, yes, I am also on this one too, again, as well.
And all the way from Burbank, California, the guest choice guest of honor himself, Luke Ski.
Who would have thought this podcast would have ended up here?
And like I said, this episode is a guest choice episode.
Be our guest
choice.
Be our guest
choice.
Put our service to the test
choice.
In which we temporarily bypass the randomizer and watch what one of my guests wants us to watch. In this case, the great Luke Ski. Luke, as you know, after you've been on this show 10 times or more, as you have, you get one guest choice option, and you will only ever get one guest choice option. You have chosen this week to use it, and you've chosen to quote-unquote make us watch The Emperor's New Groove. So, of course, now, Luke, the question must be, why The Emperor's New Groove?
I'm going to list some films from Walt Disney Animation Studios in chronological order. Aladdin, The Emperor's New Groove, Meet the Robinsons, Wreck-It Ralph, Ralph Breaks the Internet, and just for the sake of respecting the old school, I'll throw The Jungle Book in there. So those five movies, roughly speaking, I'd have to say, are my favorite films of all time from Walt Disney animated feature films.
I think you listed six movies there.
I did?
Yeah, including both Ralphs.
The Wreck-It Ralph expanded universe.
Let's throw out Jungle Book then.
All right.
Aladdin, Emperor's New Groove, Meet the Robinsons, Wreck-It Ralph, and Ralph Breaks the Internet. So, off the top of my head, without having done any major research, I'd have to say that those are probably my five favorite Walt Disney animated feature films of all time. And generally speaking, over my life, if you'd have asked me which one is my favorite, I would have said Aladdin. But with the passage of time, and especially considering these other films, it's really hard for me to say which one of these five films would genuinely be the top. I'm too busy right now to, like, make ranking my favorite movies of all time a project, because believe me, I can do that. I've got the ADHD and executive function to make that an all-day project. But I think that Emperor's New Groove just might be number one. When that movie came out in 2000, I saw it in the movie theater in Lake Geneva, Wisconsin. I was by myself. The commercials just made me really interested to see what this weird comedy was all about. And I just loved it. I don't know if it was financially like a flop at the theater or whatever, but it kind of felt like one of those secret movies that not everybody knew about. Hey, have you seen The Emperor's New Groove? No. Oh, you gotta see Emperor's New Groove.
It certainly developed a cult fan base over time, yeah, in a way that a lot of quote-unquote secret movies eventually do. It just spreads by friends telling each other, oh man, you gotta see this movie, you gotta see this movie, it's so good. And yeah, that's how cult classics happen.
The first Austin Powers movie was the exact same thing. I saw that in a movie theater in Toledo when I was traveling across the country performing at conventions, and it came out to next to no fanfare, just a regular old comedy coming out, no big deal.
Oh, the guy who did Wayne's World, yeah, he's on his bullshit again.
And by the time the second Austin Powers movie came out, it was a huge deal.
That's kind of the ultimate example of a cult classic that just spreads by word of mouth, although that one spread a little bit faster than Emperor's New Groove did.
I'm so glad that this movie gets memed, this movie gets referenced. Everybody knows what it is. Everyone who knows it really loves it, and it has a lot more respect than it used to have, but it still feels underrepresented in the whole Disney pantheon of everything. You can't find any Emperor's New Groove stuff at the parks. It still feels like it's kind of an underdog secret cult following movie.
Certainly by Disney standards, it's an underrepresented cult classic because, yeah, it does get a lot of love, especially from, I guess, millennials. People who grew up with it as the weird Disney movie that they really gravitated towards because it's so weird. Disney's biggest hits are these massive fucking world-shaping phenomenons like The Little Mermaid and The Lion King and the Marvel Cinematic Universe. When you've got that level of success at your disposal, something like The Emperor's New Groove is gonna get overlooked, no matter how big a cult audience it is, because it is still a cult audience.
Do you think maybe they like having it be a cult movie a little bit? Like, they keep stuff a little bit available for it. I can go to Box Lunch and I have a super cool Cusco t-shirt from there. I think they like having something that's culturally memeable.
It's definitely in the B tier, but it feels at home in the B tier, if that makes any sense. That's almost kind of where it belongs. Just because it's so weird and idiosyncratic, it almost feels like if this movie was too popular, it would almost defeat the purpose. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It feels like almost if it was Lion King huge, it would kind of ruin it.
Yeah, I feel like they have a similar relationship to a Goofy movie.
Yes, absolutely. I'm kind of in the same boat as Luke, in a sense. When this movie came out, I was kind of done with Disney, at least for a while. I was in my teenage, Disney sucks, it's corporate, sellout bullshit. But the ads for this intrigued me. In part, I was just curious, like, what is this? Because that's another thing. The ads didn't do a great job of spelling out exactly what this movie even was. Like, the poster was just this image of human Cusco next to llama Cusco, like they're two different characters, against a blank white background, and it just said, Llama Llama Ding Dong, and then the movie title and release date. Can't imagine why that didn't do too well, but I saw it in theaters out of sheer morbid curiosity, and yeah, I absolutely fell in love with it. How did this get past Disney? Like, how did Disney let this happen? It's like that old Stan Freberg line, my records don't get released, they escape. This absolutely feels like a movie that escaped.
When this came out, I was working in a CD-ROM studio in Connecticut. And when the trailer dropped, I was immediately into it because I could tell, first of all, it was going to be like a loonier, toonier affair than usual Disney flick. But also, I was a big fan of Cats Don't Dance, and Mark Dindal directed both that and this.
Right, right.
But I remember finding a way to download the trailer so I could look at it frame by frame and take screen caps to use as desktop wallpaper and stuff. And I went to see the movie, and I was completely blown away. And this is the only movie I have seen in a theater five times because I kept dragging people to it. The super awesome two-disc Emperor's New Groove DVD set was one of the first DVDs I owned.
I remember that.
It was like Clerks the Animated Series and this, so I watched it a lot.
It just occurred to me, Clerks the Animated Series has more in common with Emperor's New Groove than you would ever think. They both have kind of a similar flexible reality, fourth wall breaking kind of vibe to them. Although the Clerks series has more sex jokes.
See, now I want to draw Cusco Llama as Jay and Pacha yes. as Silent Bob.
I'm sitting here trying to remember my feelings on this movie when it came out, because I would have been 15, and so I think maybe I was at the point where I was getting too old for Disney movies. I probably did go see this in theaters just because my dad was way into animation, and so pretty much we went to see every animated movie, but I don't remember my feelings on it when it came out, so I might have just not been in the right headspace for it. But cut to my adulthood, and I'm married to Kyle, and he's like, you know what? Emperor's New Groove. And I was like, yeah, okay, we can Emperor's New Groove. And we watched it, and he's like, holy crap, this is amazing. And now it's just this movie that we can go back to time and time again, especially, you know, now working in animation, just noticing all of these things that it gets right and does so well. It's just this weird, wacky cartoon Disney movie that still fully has that Disney heart to it. It's an amazing nugget. Happy to watch it anytime Luke demands it.
Not counting the Roger Rabbit stuff. The Emperor's New Groove was probably the Looney Tuniest Disney feature that had ever come out.
Oh, yeah. In fact, I would go as far as to say it's not even close. Aladdin has some of that, but it's concentrated in the genie areas. This just unleashes it.
This is a 78-minute Looney Tunes cartoon. It really is. In Roger Ebert's review of it, if I'm remembering that correctly, he said something to the effect of, for the last 20 or so years as a critic, I've been trained to refer to animated features as animated features and not as cartoons. This is a cartoon, and I mean that as a compliment.
And then later on, back when, of course, there was still the direct-to-DVD movie market happening, they put out Kronk's New Groove because there was enough of a following. Hey, the kids all like Kronk, let's make a Kronk movie.
I think the Emperor's New Groove DVDs sold really well by that point.
And then there was enough of a following for these characters that Disney ended up making the series, The Emperor's New School.
Right.
And we want to give a shout-out to our friend Micah, who does all the awesome animations.
Yes, Micah Hirsch of Fire Blast Studios. He has an animated YouTube series called Podcasts Tonighted, where he does these awesome little animations of highlights from various podcasts, including this one, Channel KRT, Podcast Without a Cool Acronym, and Kyle and Luke Talk About Tunes.
He might like this series a little.
Yeah.
Yeah, that guy is obsessed with Emperor's New Groove, and he also has his own podcast called The Emperor's New Podcast, where he just covers everything Emperor's New Groove related. Obviously the movie, obviously the sequel. He did an episode on the Sweatbox, which I'm sure we'll talk about. Right now he's in the midst of covering every episode of The Emperor's New School, and he recently did an April Fool's Day episode on The Road to El Dorado.
Nice.
Which I'm sure we'll also talk about.
Take that, Katzenberg.
I've seen Kronk's New Groove, and I've seen one full episode plus a few clips here and there of The Emperor's New School. I was kind of underwhelmed by both, I gotta say. Kronk's New Groove especially seemed really hamstrung by that Disney direct-to-video dictum of it's gotta have as much stuff from the original movie as humanly possible. There's only so much creativity allowed. Kronk's New Groove kind of comes across as someone who's seen a really good improv show trying to retell the good jokes in it, but the chemistry's not there. But, you know, we're not talking about that. We're talking about the original that's good. And, of course, we have to talk about the behind-the-scenes story of this movie.
You want to address the llama in the room?
Absolutely, because that is a really, really, really fascinating story. And a big part of the reason we know so much about the behind-the-scenes story of this movie is when this movie started in development, I guess Disney thought, okay, we got Elton John to do the Lion King soundtrack. That worked really well. We're getting Phil Collins to do the Tarzan soundtrack. Let's get Sting to do the soundtrack of this movie. Complete the trifecta of aging British pop stars your parents really like. And one of Sting's stipulations to doing the songs for this movie, which I'm deliberately not calling The Emperor's New Groove at this particular time, is that his wife, Trudy Styler, wanted to do a documentary about the making of a Disney Animated Studios film from stem to stern, just the whole process of it. And the Disney execs just thought, sure, why not? We can release that as its own thing, play it at some film festivals, give it a limited release. Sounds awesome. Yeah, sure, she can film a documentary. What they didn't know at that point was that movie, which at that point was titled Kingdom of the Sun, would be, no exaggeration, the most tumultuous production in Walt Disney Animation Studios history. To the point where, by the time it was finally finished in a completely different form as The Emperor's New Groove, The Disney execs looked at her documentary, which was called The Sweatbox, and said, yeah, we can never release this. It just reveals way too much about how the sausage for this particular project got made. We need to bury this thing deep in the Disney vault in between Song of the South and that documentary where we killed all those lemmings. And here's how secretive they were with it. John Lasseter himself, when he was still the big shit director of Toy Story guy, wanted to see it. And the Disney execs were like, okay, we'll let you see it because you're John Lasseter, but you got to come down to Burbank and watch it in one of our screening rooms. And when he did so, there were like armed guards guarding the print of the film. That's how overprotective they were, but they still apparently weren't quite overprotective enough in the long run, because in 2012, an unfinished work print cut of it was leaked to YouTube. Disney almost immediately took it down, but not before several people, myself included, downloaded it, and it's just been bouncing around the internet ever since. It is currently available to download at archive.org, and I highly recommend it. It is a very rough cut, like I said. It's not a finished movie. It has an annoying time code at the bottom, but it's a truly fascinating glimpse into what went wrong with the original version of this movie and why Disney let it turn into the crazy, brilliant movie it became.
I think it's actually kind of a travesty that they don't let this movie out. I've seen it, and I feel like it's something that every animation student needs to see to, like, realize that once you get in there, it's not necessarily going to go smoothly or all be sunshine and rainbows.
Well, they're not going to release it as is because there's way too many scenes of people swearing and telling adult jokes and shit like that, but I could see them patching things up with Trudy Styler, saying, yeah, the old management were a bunch of idiots, let's work with this thing, finding all her old footage and recutting it into something new that's a look back at this tumultuous production. I could see them doing that now, maybe as something for Disney Plus. But anyway, for those who haven't seen The Sweatbox, the short version of why The Emperor's New Groove is so unlike any other Disney movie is that they realized, like, halfway through, when they had already poured a shitload of money into Kingdom of the Sun, that it just wasn't working as a story. So the story team spent, like, a month or so trying to reconfigure it and rearrange the elements of the story, and nothing was really working until someone pitched a super streamlined version of the story that only preserved a few basic elements, but otherwise was a completely different movie. And the execs really responded to that more than anything else they were pitching, so that's the direction they went in. Now, at that point, the two directors on the project were Roger Allers, who had co-directed The Lion King, and Mark Dindal, who, as you said, directed Cats Don't Dance. And Roger Allers, when these story changes were made, just realized this is no longer the movie I'm interested in directing, and he very gracefully and politely left the project.
You know, I try and I try. There's just no respect for anyone with vision. That's it. There's just nothing I can do about it.
So now it was all up to Mark Dindal to bring this sucker home, and by that point, they were way behind schedule, and the executives basically let Mark Dindal do whatever the hell he wanted within this very basic story that everyone had agreed on, just so they could have something by the release date, some releasable product that they could send into movie theaters. And the execs didn't futz with it nearly as much as they ordinarily would have because they were under a time crunch, so the movie became what it became, and cinema is all the better for it.
It will change and change and change and change, and it is that additive process that keeps making it
although
fresh.
I don't recall one that quite has changed. We always say, oh, this is normal. Everything's like, we've never been through this before.
Here's how much they changed the movie. Yzma was the only character in the whole movie to keep her name, her basic design, and her voice actor. Everyone else changed at least one of those things. Cusco was originally named Manco, but then someone informed them that in Japanese, manko is a slang term that refers to female genitalia. So, and this is just my conjecture, but I'm guessing the person who informed them of that was an anime fan. That's just my wild guess.
And that's not what bothered them. It means bad movie in Turkish. And they didn't want that.
And Pacha was originally a very different character because Kingdom of the Sun was originally a Prince and the Pauper story where Pacha was this young llama herder who looked exactly like Emperor Manco slash Cusco, and they switch places and shenanigans ensue. And that version of Pacha was going to be voiced by Owen Wilson.
We're twins.
Impossible.
No, then I bet we're distant cousins because we look exactly alike.
And this was before Owen Wilson was a huge star. They would have been working on this in the late 90s, back when Owen Wilson was just like a character actor in Wes Anderson movies.
Well, the good thing is he had another chance in the beloved Cars franchise, which Tony Goldmark loves so much.
Yes, of course. Kingdom of the Sun originally was much more about the spiritualism and mysticism of ancient Inca culture. And it was very grandiose and, if we're being 100% honest, more than a little pretentious.
The creator, Viracocha, wanted the world to have light. So he threw a rope to a distant star. This star was Inti, the sun. Inti battled Supai.
Yzma originally had a song in Kingdom of the Sun called Snuff Out the Light, which is, by the way, on the Emperor's New Groove soundtrack.
Great song.
Several of the songs that Sting wrote for the original version of the movie ended up on the Emperor's New Groove soundtrack album. They make no sense because they don't correlate whatsoever to the story actually being told. But Snuff Out the Light is a great song. I would have loved to see that as a finished animated sequence.
Snuff out the light. Claim your right.
From everything I've seen of the old version of the movie, including the sequences you can see in the big old coffee table book Paper Dreams, which is a book about Disney storyboarding, I am super glad they didn't make that movie. Mm. Like, there are cool elements about it. Like, I really like that Yzma song that they cut, and right. I'm sure Andreas Deja's animation for it is amazing. But I feel like it was going to hit too many familiar tones to all of the movies that were being made at that time, not only by Disney, but by everybody else. Disney already did a Prince and the Pauper thing with Mickey.
Yeah.
I feel like instead letting Dindal do what he wanted to do, and just because of the circumstances, letting it actually be what he wanted it to be, it's probably a more cohesive standout film than it was going to be.
Emperor's New Groove is a much better film than Kingdom of the Sun would have been. A few of the ideas in it intrigue me, but ultimately it just seemed like a colossal mess.
We have a love interest, a Prince and the Pauper switch, a classic villain. She's got a relationship with a primordial being.
And I'm pretty sure the only reason that the powers that be at Disney let Kingdom of the Sun get as far as it got is because they felt like they owed it to Roger Allers. Because no one believed in The Lion King either. Like, Jeffrey Katzenberg famously considered The Lion King the B project, whereas Pocahontas was the A project, and look what happened there. So, you know, Roger Allers clearly knew what he was doing with The Lion King, and they felt like, well, he's bound to know what he's doing on this as well, right? And then, no. And I feel like on Lion King, Roger Allers was the more serious director. He brought more of the darker, more dramatic elements to the movie. And Rob Minkoff was more of the goofball. He had directed Roger Rabbit shorts before he got the Lion King job. And I think he brought more of the comic relief elements to it. And it obviously worked very well for that film. And I think that's why Mark Dindal was hired as the co-director of Kingdom of the Sun.
That makes sense.
And we should talk about Dindal's career, because he started at Disney as an effects animator.
Which is wild. Like, the guy who was responsible for all these cartoony movies was an effects animator?
When Disney made The Little Mermaid, he was the guy who had to draw like a kajillion bubbles. That was his whole job.
Just imagining him sitting there animating bubbles going, soon.
Yes. I mean, he started at Disney in 1980, fresh out of Cal Arts.
Jeez.
He was one of many, many, many future directors to waste his talents on The Fox and the Hound. And we talked about this when we covered The Rocketeer on this podcast, but he also directed the animated sequence in The Rocketeer, the animated Nazi propaganda film that the characters watch in one scene. That was all Mark Dindal. That was, I think, the first thing he ever directed. Then he left Disney for a while, went and directed Cats Don't Dance for Turner. That movie, unfortunately, didn't make a lot of money.
Yeah, it was kind of a victim of a regime change.
Yeah, but Cats Don't Dance is still a great movie. We do recommend that.
Yeah.
And it was enough to impress Disney to go, let's hire this guy back as a proper director. And when the decision was made to completely rework Kingdom of the Sun mid-production, Dindal and his story team just simplified the story like crazy and just made it a buddy comedy between Cusco and Pacha. They got rid of the love interest, they got rid of the side characters, they got rid of the mystical shit, they got rid of the convoluted Prince and the Pauper plot.
You don't want them to come in and go, oh, you know what? We don't like that idea of the one guy looking like the other guy. Let's get rid of the basis of the movie. This would be a good time for them to tell us.
And I think the Disney executives were just like, well, we've already sunk a shitload of money into this Kingdom of the Sun project, and this at least makes us laugh, so yeah, sure, why the hell not?
I consider myself one of the most empathetic people in the world. I think I'm empathetic to the point of being detrimental to my greater well-being.
Right.
So I saw the sweatbox, and I feel bad about all of that, but at the same time, to quote somebody we all look up to, I don't give a shit where the stuff I love comes from! I just love the stuff I love!
I don't care, I don't care. The movie didn't get made, I don't care.
There was so much drama, and now I am a llama. I don't care. He does not care.
He doesn't care.
By the way, interesting side story to all this. By the time Disney made the decision to completely rework the story for Kingdom of the Sun, they had already assembled the full animation staff. Some of the shots had already gone through the entire process of animation. A couple of shots were finalized. That's how far they were into it. And all of a sudden, all these animators had nothing to do because the story team needed to take a few extra months to re-storyboard the whole movie. Enter Eric Goldberg. Sensing an opportunity, Goldberg swoops in and says, hey, what if I keep the Kingdom of the Sun team busy for a few months by doing that Rhapsody in Blue sequence I really want to do for Fantasia 2000?
I was thinking about Disney and cartoony and wondering how Eric Goldberg wasn't on this movie.
Well, I think he was busy working on Fantasia 2000. He'd already done the Carnival of the Animals sequence with the flamingos and the yo-yo.
That age-old question... What would happen if you gave a yo-yo to a flock of flamingos? Who wrote this?
But what he really wanted to do was this Rhapsody in Blue sequence, which the executives had already turned down. They were like, nah, this is Fantasia. We gotta stick to classical. If we put a jazz sequence in there, we're basically just make mine music. But then Eric Goldberg came back when this problem needed solving, and the exec said, fine, we gotta do something with these people. Knock yourself out. And of course, Rhapsody in Blue is the best scene in Fantasia 2000. Go figure.
Yes.
And it was tax deductible.
Indeed it was. We should also at least briefly talk about Road to El Dorado, a DreamWorks movie that's remarkably similar to a Disney movie that came out the same year. Who would have imagined? In the wake of the whole Ants and a Bug's Life thing, Jeffrey Katzenberg was once again trying to steal Disney's thunder. Oh, they're doing a movie set in South America? We'll do our movie set in South America, only it'll be like a Bing Crosby, Bob Hope road movie type thing.
With blackjack and hookers.
Well, there are gambling scenes in Road to El Dorado, and Chell is kind of, well, never mind.
Perhaps another time? Another place?
Too bad. I'm free now.
She's birdie is what she is.
Yeah, that is one of the big things Road to El Dorado has over Emperor's New Groove. Emperor's New Groove does not have Chell in it. But anyway, Road to El Dorado came out spring of 2000, and it was produced at a time when they thought Kingdom of the Sun was going to come out summer of 2000. That, of course, ended up not happening because of the delay as they switched it to a different movie. I think at first it was going to be Thanksgiving 2000, but they were just way too behind, and they were like, fuck it, December. So the similarities between the two movies ended up being kind of a non-issue, since the Emperor's New Groove was turned into such a radically different movie, and the movies were released almost a year apart from each other.
If Kingdom of the Sun had come out the way it was originally envisioned, that would have really felt like people looking at the DreamWorks movie versus the Disney movie and go, oh god, this DreamWorks movie is so much better than this Disney movie.
Yeah.
Now Disney's copied DreamWorks. Plus the fact that DreamWorks got Elton John, the guy from Lion King,
right,
to do the music. So the fact that it got all reworked, became Emperor's New Groove, came out in December, and it's a cartoon. It's so loony and intentionally out there. There is a great disconnect between those two. And even though technically, yeah, you could draw the line between the two of them, I just still think they're both two really great separate movies.
It is one of the better early DreamWorks movies, to be sure.
There's a meme image out there somewhere of somebody was on Reddit or somewhere talking about the character design of Yzma and how amazing this character looks to look at, and was basically saying, like, this is one of the most attractive character designs ever made by Disney. And, like, some other person chimes in, it's like, oh, you think Yzma's attractive? What kind of freak are you? And it's like, you can see a character design is attractive without making it about sex.
Yeah.
You goober. We're saying she looks really cool.
Although, I guarantee when Yzma was a young woman, she was smoking hot. She just has that vibe.
Probably looked like Eartha Kitt.
Yeah, it's like that Flat 29 song. You're an old lady who used to be hot.
Yeah. And let me get it straight, I'm not weird or crazy. I wouldn't look twice at most old ladies. There's something that they're lacking, but it's something you've got. Because you're an old lady that used to be hot.
And she kind of has that flapper aesthetic. I would love to see a cosplayer cosplay as what young Yzma would have looked like.
Oh, that's a cool idea.
And Krong Kronk was not in Kingdom of the Sun at all. He was completely added for Emperor's New Groove.
Kronk's very existence is a really diddly idea.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't think it's controversial to say this is easily the best David Spade movie ever made. David Spade is most tolerable when he's Cusco. Although Tommy Boy, I guess, is a funny movie. But otherwise, like, I was never that big a fan of his on SNL. I can't stand the work he's done with Adam Sandler. But in this movie, he's fucking brilliant. Leave it to Disney Animation.
That's because he had an actual straight man who was a straight man in this movie.
Right, right.
Chris Farley is the straight man. Like, I appreciate them as a comedy team. I like an old-fashioned comedy team. But I feel like the extremeness that is Cusco. Cusco's really concentrated Spade. But yes. Then you have John Goodman at his most heartwarming, his most family comedy. As a counterbalance, and it works so well.
They have amazing chemistry together in this movie.
I've always wondered, was it meant to be Chris Farley doing the voice of Pacho when this whole change around happened? We could basically have an animated Farley and Spade road movie comedy, but Farley passed away in December of 1997.
They would not have made the decision to completely overhaul the movie at that point, so unfortunately Farley would have already been dead by the time they needed a new Pacha. And like I said, the old Pacha was ironically a young Pacha, voiced by Owen Wilson in this Prince and the Pauper thing. So Farley never would have been literally attached to it like he famously was to Shrek.
People see me and they go, "Ah! Help! A big, stupid, stinky, smelly, ugly ogre! I'm so scared!"
But it's possible that they were trying to get some of that Farley and Spade energy happening. I mean, the one thing that everyone seemed to like about Kingdom of the Sun was David Spade as this arrogant emperor.
"I can't believe I've been here this long and no one's kissed my feet."
So it's very possible that when they were desperately trying to think of new takes on the material, the take that worked was, let's just take David Spade's character and team him up with a Chris Farley-esque character, and then we can do an animated Tommy Boy, only with the roles reversed so that David Spade is playing the privileged dipshit who needs to learn how to grow the fuck up. And maybe that's why they cast John Goodman, because they thought, who's the most alive, lovable, funny, fat guy in Hollywood? And Jack Black wasn't famous enough yet.
I've always wondered if it had anything to do with John Goodman's casting in Monsters, Inc., since that was probably in production around the same time.
Perhaps, although I have no idea when this switchover happened, but originally Sully was going to be voiced by John Cusack.
Oh.
Although that was not nearly as much of a last-minute change, so yeah, maybe John Goodman had already been cast as Sully, and the Disney folks in Burbank were like, "Hey, Pixar, can we borrow King Ralph for a minute?"
I just looked up on Wikipedia. It was in 1997 that Roger Ailes asked Sting
Roger
to...
Roger Ailes?
Roger Ailes
was the evil dead guy who founded Fox News.
Roger Allers, excuse me.
A little different.
So when they changed the movie to a completely different movie, obviously they also changed the title. At first, they changed Kingdom of the Sun to Kingdom in the Sun, which is barely a title change at all. Then ultimately, they settle on Emperor's New Groove as the movie's title, which no one really likes as a title all that much. There's a scene in the sweatbox where Sting hears the new title and cringes.
What's the title?
The Emperor's New Groove.
Yeah, I think that might have kept some people from the theaters thinking that it was going to be a lot of reference jokes and gosh, we think we're cool.
It's hard to know what to make of a movie that calls itself The Emperor's New Groove.
There was a movie from 1998, How Stella Got Her Groove Back.
Right, right.
So it's like, wait, is this...
Here's how fucking cursed this movie is, just in production. Even at the 11th hour, when they're almost finally done with the thing, they had to replace the composer of the score. Like, originally they hired Mark Shaman, and then they looked at his score and it wasn't working, so they had to fire him and hire John Debney at the absolute 11th hour and 59th minute. It was such a mess, this production. It's almost a miracle that the film works at all.
Yeah, given the situation, like, it's a formula for a nightmare, but because they let Dindal do Dindal things... it became something with a singular creative vision.
And of course, a few years after Groove, they hired Dindal to direct another feature for Disney, which ended up being Chicken Little, which we talked about on a previous episode. And that didn't work so well, and I attribute that to the Disney executives taking the polar opposite tack that they took on Emperor's New Groove, whereas with Emperor's New Groove, they were just, ah, fuck it, just get it done. You know what you're doing, you're a funny guy, just give us something we can release. Whereas on Chicken Little, they thought it was going to be their first post-Pixar CGI movie, so they were like, it's got to be this, it's got to be that. They were micromanaging it a lot more, and it ruined it.
I can practically guarantee that that is indeed the difference.
And has Mark Dindal really done anything since Chicken Little?
There have been so many things that almost happened, so many huge projects that would have been like, oh, this is the next big Dindal thing that didn't end up getting produced.
And by the way, Kyle, earlier you mentioned that two-disc DVD set of Emperor's New Groove that came out.
Yes.
None of the special features acknowledge that it was a whole different movie originally. Some of the footage from the sweatbox eventually made it into some of the special features, but they didn't mention the tumultuous history of the movie at all. I don't think they were allowed to. And also, speaking of DVD bonus features, when Who Framed Roger Rabbit came out on DVD in 2003, it wasn't the first DVD release of Roger Rabbit, but it was the first big Roger Rabbit two-disc set with a lot of bonus features. And in the menus, they shot all this new live-action footage of Maroon Cartoon Studios, and Cusco fucking shows up.
Yep.
Nice.
Fucking Cusco is in the Roger Rabbit DVD menus, and he's the only modern character to show up there just completely randomly. So someone working on that set was an Emperor's New Groove fan.
Beat.
Kyle would often, when we were working on Mighty Magiswords, have these meetings with all the boarders to talk about his vision for how visually he wanted the show to look and how to like frame characters and this and that. And at one point, I can't remember if we actually watched the whole movie or we just watched parts of it, but basically breaking down things from the Emperor's New Groove was really like a helpful tool at one point. I mean, especially looking at some of the early scenes where Yzma and Kronk are standing next to each other and just seeing the character design of Yzma with the way she stands, but also like her weird hat and the thing in the back that like curls around into a spiral. And then Kronk is standing there like this big giant triangle. The way they take up the frame, the silhouetting of it.
Well, there's a lot of talking going on. You can kind of tell exactly who everybody is just by looking at them.
Yeah,
you can turn
yeah.
the sound off and get an idea of what's going on in this movie. One of the scenes that I particularly pointed out to the crew was the scene where she keeps setting up the Cusco head statues and smashing them.
Who does that ungrateful little worm think he is? Does he? A little to the left. Have any idea of who he's dealing with?
That was just a really interesting bit of very funny visual business for a scene where they had to do a lot of exposition.
I never noticed it until you brought it up, but I do see a lot of Yzma and Kronk influence just in the designs of Morbidia and Gateau. I can see that, yeah.
It wasn't necessarily intentional, but like everything about this movie is so ingrained within me.
Right, right. I think it's ingrained within all of us. We've all obviously seen this movie many, many times. We're about to see it again. And we'll be right back with our thoughts on Luke Ski's guest's choice of the 2000 Disney animated classic, The Emperor's New Groove, right here on Escape from Vault Disney. Yeah,
my spinach buffs!
Come on home. See what's waiting for you. Waiting for you.
All right, we just watched The Emperor's New Groove and... yeah, that was every bit as great as I remembered it. It's a fantastic, once-in-a-lifetime miracle movie that, in many ways, shouldn't have worked, and yet does.
It is amazing to know what a fraught history this movie has, because the end product is so tight. You guys mentioned that they kind of threw out all of this stuff and just nipped it down to the bare essentials, and that's what this movie is. All of the fat is trimmed off of this movie. There is nothing that is non-essential. There's some stuff that feels like it might be frivolous, like the squirrel that shows up. It's like, oh, how funny is this squirrel? He popped the balloon.
Or Kronk's shoulder angel and shoulder devil.
Yeah, exactly. And then they show up later and they're 100% essential to everything that's happening. But because they've stripped it down to just these most important characters and beats, the stuff that is there is allowed to fully breathe and play and flourish and be the best version of it that it can possibly be. The most non-essential thing that always sticks out to me in the movie as like, why is that there? Is the baby jaguar that
blows it? Yeah, I noticed that too.
Was this in there in some older version and they thought it was really cute so they left it in?
I think they just wanted a cute baby jaguar.
For one shot.
Why not?
We don't get callbacks to baby jaguar not adding anything, but it's like, that's the most non-essential thing in the entire movie and it's a blip. This movie is so fucking tight. Everything serves to move the narrative forward, and it's so good.
The scene where they go to the secret lab and suddenly they're in frigging cartoon lab coats. This is the moment where we went from, this is going to be a Disney-level cartoony movie to, oh, this is a cartoon.
Yup, with a capital C.
Complete with the smash it with a hammer sequence.
I'll turn him into a flea. A harmless little flea. And then I'll put that flea in a box. And then I'll put that box inside of another box. And then I'll nail that box to myself. And when it arrives, I'll smash it with a hammer!
Or to save on postage.
That's like our indication of just how far this is willing to go in cartoony land. And it's interesting how they gradually brought that out.
So many of the most classic jokes that everyone remembers, so many of the most memeable jokes in this, are lampshading. It's fitting, honestly, that we're doing this right after Muppet Month, because in addition to being a feature-long Looney Tune, this is kind of the closest Disney feature animation has ever come to making a Muppet movie, with so many fourth wall breaks and nods to the camera like, yeah, we know this is all bullshit, and so do you, and we're gonna have some fun with acknowledgement of that. I mean, probably the biggest lampshade in the movie is, well, you got me, by all accounts it doesn't make sense, or... What are the odds of this trapdoor leading right here?
For the last time, we did not order a giant trampoline. You know, pal, you could have told me that before I set it up.
What makes this movie really succeed is that the filmmakers had impeccable instincts of how to do a lot of lampshading without it ever getting obnoxious. Because it's so easy for a lot of lampshading to get obnoxious, and it never quite does in this movie.
Compared to Hercules, in a way.
Oh, absolutely! Yeah. The lampshading in Hercules gets very obnoxious.
It's sprinkled in so nicely, where it comes in after we've had this heightened action movie, or this tense, dramatic moment, and then we get this little sprinkle that still serves the story and everything, but it's just this fun little thing to relieve tension, or continue the action, or something like that. It's just used so perfectly and precisely.
I mean, in the final action sequence, it feels like we get a bunch of them in a row.
Oh, sure, but by that, we've reached the roaring climax of the movie, and so it's like, yeah, all right, let's do all of it. Octopus, whale, trampoline.
By that point, we know what movie this is.
Yeah.
The moment you see the map, you know all bets are off.
We're either on board or we're not.
It's kind of like playing with your expectations constantly. Like, the long, slow pan towards Kronk, who is sleeping underneath his tiny pup tent.
Yes.
And then he says the stupid thing...
The peasant at the diner. He didn't pay his check.
And then you zoom back out and you think that's going to be the end. And then the fast zoom in!
Yes!
It's the peasant who I saw leaving the city who disappeared into the crowd with Cusco in the back of his cart.
It makes you think that the whole joke is Kronk's being an idiot again and that's the whole scene. And then it subverts its own subversion. This movie's always 10 steps ahead of you.
They want to constantly toy with your expectations.
And it's great.
In my opinion, the biggest lampshade of the movie is when the film literally stops.
Yes.
So Llama Cusco can come out and... remind everyone that this movie is about him.
Well, that's the most Looney Tunes joke in the movie. That's the most Tex Avery.
Also may have been addressing a note.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That seems like it was addressing somebody's note, because it would have made more sense if that had happened 30 seconds earlier when you see Pacha, before he actually gets home and is about to literally discover Cusco on the cart. The reminder would have made more sense earlier, but instead, no, Cusco's going to remind you 5 seconds before he shows up on the cart.
It probably was a reaction to a note. It probably was the exec saying, you know, we've been spending a lot of time on Pacha. We should cut to, like, Cusco in the bag, maybe starting to wake up.
Anytime Cusco's not on screen, everyone should be asking, where's Cusco?
But instead, of course, the filmmakers were like, all right, fuck you. You want Cusco to be back in the movie? Fine. We'll do fucking duck amuck for you people. We'll do llama a mama, basically.
Which I can tell you from experience, and extensive watching of OKKO, that is 100% always the best way to address a note.
Yes.
I remember Kyle was working on Magiswords, and we just came from a meeting where you got a bunch of notes, and you were just so angry at how unimportant and stupid those notes were that you had to address. So you were basically literally making up replacement lines on the fly for the animatic right there in your chair. Whatever your frustrated mind said at that point became the line. It's like, let's do the thing with stuff. Okay, fine. What's the next one? Wait, that's the line? Yes, that's the line. We're moving on! And all that stuff made it into the episode, and everyone who gave those notes didn't say boo. It's like that apparently solved the problem for them.
Well, here's the thing. To our specific exec's credit, their general thing is if the execution of the note made them laugh, it was thumbs up.
They didn't care if the joke was at their expense as long as it made them laugh.
Most of the time.
That's good. That's what you want. Because they simplified everything and basically just centered it around these four characters. I mean, you've also got Potch's family, but primarily it's these four characters that drive the entire narrative. This movie actually ends up being a really effective portrait of narcissism. Because that's what Cusco is. He's one of the most blatant narcissists in the history of cinema, where he just thinks it's normal that the whole world revolves around him and that everyone caters to his every whim. And he doesn't see anything wrong with that. And he has to learn that, holy shit, my whole life has been a lie. In particular, right after the waterfall scene, Pacha is frustratingly trying to explain the concept of empathy to this fucking idiot. I feel that scene so fucking hard, especially now. Someone on the writing staff had an unrepentant narcissist in their family, I guarantee, because scene just captures the sheer exasperation of trying to deal with selfish, immature assholes. You just kind of want to fucking scream at them eventually. I don't know how else to tell you that you should care about people other than yourself. You know how when you go outside, you see all those lumps of flesh and clothing walking around? Those are called other people. And they're not just robots programmed to make the Matrix more realistic. You're not fucking Neo, you goddamn jagoff.
Hey, others.
The other thing that ties into that, of course, is who raised Cusco?
Yeah.
Yzma. And there's Yzma.
You really should have thought of that before you became peasants.
She's what led to Cusco. She's basically a female Mitch McConnell.
It's actually, if you think about it, kind of brave of them to allow this character to be a deliberately unappealing person.
Absolutely.
At the beginning, they are no stranger to flawed characters, to be sure, but usually they're not this flawed, and I'm glad that they let it happen.
Cusco's a straight-up villain in the first act.
When I give the word, your little town thingy will be bye-bye.
I mean, he's almost more of a bad guy than the bad guys. Yzma's only slightly worse than Cusco, and Kronk's not even really a bad guy at all. He's just doing what he's told. But at the same time, Cusco's sheer abrasive edginess also allows the movie a certain edginess that not too many Disney movies of the time really had. Like when Pacha just straight up spells out the message of the movie.
Someday you're gonna wind up all alone, and you'll have no one to blame but yourself.
Thanks for that. I'll log that away.
Speaking to teenage edgelords like myself in the audience. Wow, that's how I would have responded to that. Thanks, Dad.
One of the reasons that this movie works as well as it does is that everything that every character does is 100% specific to that character.
Yes.
So when you look at that scene, it's a big exposition scene. It's a big explainy-talky scene. But everything visual that's going on has to do with who these two characters are. Pacha is trying to make everything work, and he's trying to start a fire, and everything Cusco does puts out that fire.
Yeah! He spits on the fire, he fucking shakes himself off, and that puts the fire out.
He uses his friggin' tunic as a towel.
He throws the tunic on the fire, and then at the end, he's like, are you gonna build a fire or what? Let's go!
Exactly!
That is an excellent visual metaphor.
He even builds a tiny friggin' Cusco-topia out of rocks. There is visual representation to everything that is being said, so we never lose visual interest while we're saying stuff.
And you're right, it's all character-based.
That is what happens throughout the entire movie. It never lets up on that, and that is why it works.
I mean, that starts right from the beginning of this movie, when you see Cusco's shivering, it's raining in the jungle, and he's just miserable. And the narration says at one point, I was the world's nicest guy, and they ruined my life for no reason. And before you've even seen a second of this guy being a human, you know that's bullshit.
Yep.
You can never trust anyone who makes declarative, positive statements about themselves like that. Anyone who says, I'm the world's nicest guy, is anything but.
By the way, you can get my music at thegreatlukeski.com. That's thegreatlukeski.com.
You can even see from how obnoxious he's being about being stuck out in the rain that perhaps you should not be buying what this guy's selling.
Why do we like Cusco? To quote the movie, by all accounts, it doesn't make sense. He's nothing but an arrogant jerk for most of the running time. He's displacing this whole goddamn town to suit his own selfish ego. He's voiced by David Spade, for fuck's sake. He should be the most unlikable son of a bitch in any movie. And yet, when he gets to the point where he's at his lowest moment, he's accepted that he's gonna be a llama for the rest of his life. He tries to eat grass. We actually do kind of feel for him in a weird way. A lot of our laughter at his misfortune is pure schadenfreude because he's been such a jerk. But ultimately, we as the audience don't quite just want to give up on him. We want him to grow and become a better person, or at least a better llama. Is it just that it's such a character-based movie that we never lose sight of what kind of character he is? Or is it just that the animators did such a good job?
It's kind of a combination of things. There's sort of a Wile E. Coyote factor to Cusco, where he's so entertaining at failing, and we don't necessarily want to see him succeed.
Right,
we don't really necessarily want to see Wile E. Coyote devour a roadrunner, but his attempts are so funny, and there's sort of a counter-reaction to everything that he does, and the only times when it doesn't is when we are especially meant to see him as a villain.
It also establishes that he's turning 18, so I think maybe there's also a little bit of, well, of course he's a spoiled, petulant brat, he's a teenager, but also, is it because deep down, we all kind of wish we could be Cusco? Is there something about this particular character that stimulates our inner selfish 18-year-old?
Well, I mean, that's David Spade's entire career.
Of course.
You keep referencing David Spade as if everybody hates David Spade, and I think you are mistaken.
You love to hate him because he's putting on an asshole-ish personality, but it's, again, so entertaining that it's like, oh, this jerk, oh, I love him.
This and Tommy Boy are the only two good movies he was ever in, at least as far as I'm concerned. I mean, can you think of any others?
The Hotel Transylvania movies.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I guess so.
All three of those and Coneheads.
Oh, yeah, he was in Coneheads, wasn't he? Yeah, he was funny in Coneheads. I'll give him that. And by the way, you'll notice in the bridge scene, right before he breaks one of the little wooden planks and falls down himself, he straight up says, bye-bye.
Yep.
He references Total Bastard Airlines.
Just got one in.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Hey, you live here in Pittsburgh?
No, actually, I'm here.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. We all know that a lot of these voice sessions, they film the voice actors so that the animators can get a visual reference for what these actors are looking like when they're saying their lines.
Mm-hmm.
I have to believe they were filming David Spade during the scene where he chucks the rock at Potch's head.
Huh? What? I didn't do anything. Somebody's throwing stuff.
And then he has that little face pop of like, that is such a David Spadian move that just kills me every time I see it.
I do know something interesting about them filming David Spade. They came to realize that David Spade gave them more enthusiasm and a better performance if he thought he was being filmed for the press. So on several occasions, they lied to him and told him he was being filmed for the press when he was not, so he could get a better performance out of him. It totally worked.
There you go. There's one kind of subtle moment in this movie that I just absolutely love, and I think it actually goes a long way towards making Cusco a relatable character. It's that animation moment where Cusco sits on his throne and just kind of takes a moment to settle himself and get comfortable before saying, okay, show him in. That's the most relatable moment for Cusco in the first half of this movie, because I feel like we've all had moments like that where we just need an extra second or two to center ourselves before we proceed to the next task at hand.
I always think about that shot every time I see it in my head. There's no dialogue there, of course, but I'm thinking, chair.
We're in the chair. We're in our happy place. It's all going to be okay. Send the next guy in.
When we go from Cusco on the throne and Pacha first enters, I love what a fake out that is. You hear that sweet music. You can help me with my problem.
Yeah.
It's trying to fool you into thinking that this is going to be a Disney movie.
Right.
30 seconds of fooling you.
And I do want to talk about the two songs that Sting did for the movie. Kingdom of the Sun was a full-blown Disney animated musical, and it was no longer going to be a musical. And that was another decision born out of necessity, because Sting and his songwriting partner, David Hartley, they wrote six songs for Kingdom of the Sun, three of which eventually made it to the Emperor's New Groove soundtrack. And in the sweatbox, you can actually see the footage of the movie's producer, Randy Fulmer, calling Sting and breaking the news to him that they've changed the whole story and none of his songs are going to fit anymore. Would you be willing to write some new ones? Well, by then, Sting had already started working in earnest on his brand new Day album and just didn't have time to write a whole new musical for these goddamn fuckers who didn't know what their movie wanted to be. But he still wanted to be involved in it somehow. In his own words in the documentary, "I am not a quitter." So they renegotiated, and ultimately Sting wrote these two songs. The end credits ballad, My Funny Friend and Me, which you can take or leave, and the brilliant opening song, Perfect World, which sets the tone for the movie so perfectly.
Like Lindsay mentioned, since there's like no fat in this movie, I feel like adding songs to that
would
have simply been fat.
It would have fattened it up unnecessarily.
I have zero interest in any music Sting has ever made except for Perfect World. And possibly the Yzma song, which I know I've only heard bits of, so I need to like make a specific effort to listen to that.
Yeah, it's on the soundtrack.
I'm not saying I dislike him or that he's a bad performer. It's just a thing that has never pulled interest for me ever.
Shh, Marge, he's a good digger.
Just hearing the song My Funny Friend and Me and like, were all the songs like this? Oh my god, no, I'm so happy the movie wasn't like that.
I actually have something of a soft spot for Sting's music, and I especially gained a new appreciation for him after I saw The Sweatbox, but I fully acknowledge that he is so not everyone's cup of tea.
I was actually, in my mind, trying to scour through, what has Sting done that I really liked? What has Sting done that I really liked besides this? The only thing I can think of is he makes a cameo in Billy Crystal's You Look Marvelous video. That's the only thing I can think of.
Oh look, there's Sting looking for his last name in the dim.
Luke, have you ever seen Dune?
No!
Lucky you!
Surprisingly, no. It's one of the few geek things I haven't seen.
My ex-wife was a huge Frank Herbert fan, and she made me sit through Dune like two or three times.
Oh, more than once.
If you put a gun to my head, I still couldn't begin to tell you what the fuck that movie's about. But Sting is almost naked in it. That's the one thing I remember. He wears a fucking loincloth, and he fights Kyle MacLachlan.
I will kill him!
When Sting wrote Perfect World, the producers originally wanted Sting to be the voice of theme song guy. And Sting said, no, I specifically wrote Perfect World to be sung by a much younger performer. So, of course, they hired Tom Jones, who's 10 years older than Sting.
But it worked so good.
It worked so well. And by the way, later in the movie, when Yzma holds that fake funeral for Kuzco and then takes over the kingdom, originally, Yzma was going to sing a reprise of Perfect World about herself.
Oh.
I'll be the sovereign queen of the nation. I'm the chicest chick in creation. I'm the cat with all the cream and ooh la la. That deadly concentration put an end to my frustration. Now this perfect world begins and ends with mwah. What's my name? What's my name?
I wish they had kept that in. That would have actually fit. I guess they figured it wasn't necessary.
We don't have the time, we don't have the money, we gotta go.
Yeah, in 2D animation, every frame costs money.
I'm also so happy with the pacing of this movie that I can't imagine putting a song sequence there.
I guess the only reason I really wish they'd left it in is because it feels criminal not to have Eartha Kitt sing in this movie.
Yeah, I hear you.
I mean, her being on the soundtrack is nice, but they really should have given her at least a verse, you know? And by the way, I gotta give special praise to Eartha Kitt, because originally, the Kingdom of the Sun iteration of Yzma was much more of a traditional Eartha Kitt type. She was a seductress, she was cunning and diabolical, and she got a big, fun, vampy musical number, and I'm sure that's why they cast her. And then when they rewrote the movie, they completely changed her character. They turned her into a bitter, frustrated, quick-to-anger old grouch, and Eartha Kitt still nailed it! I mean, it's a testament to her talents, and it shows you how much she was typecast over the years.
This isn't poison. This is extract of... Llama!
I'm not the first one to point this out, but it is very true. If they had done a live-action remake of this while Eartha Kitt was still alive, every last character could have been played physically by the voice actor. But of course now Eartha Kitt's dead and everyone else is too old. If they were to do an ungodly, terrible, missing the point live-action remake of Emperor's New Groove, who would play everyone now, I wonder?
The question makes me sad.
I know.
If that was to happen, the best way they could do it is to continue the lamp shading. Like, 22 Jump Street is lampooning the notion of film sequels.
Right, right.
If this was Disney's way of lampooning their own remaking of things into live action and just lampshade the hell out of it the whole time, if it's done right, it could be brilliant.
That would be the way to go about it, definitely.
Get someone like, I don't know, James Gunn to direct it. Just make it crazy.
Or
you know?
Phil Lord and Chris Miller.
Yeah, exactly.
Although I don't know if they want to work for Disney anymore after the Solo debacle.
Yeah.
But anyway, enough desecrating the corpse of 2D animation. Let's talk about how goddamn beautiful 2D animation was.
Oh, God, yeah.
Isn't it just...
I've missed it so much. Please bring it back.
I know, man.
Please.
Especially when it's stylized like this. No other Disney animated film looks exactly like Emperor's New Groove. I mean, Hercules and Atlantis come kind of close in certain respects. They're both stylized in their own unique ways, but I really did love this period of Disney animation when they were trying to actively go for something a little different than the traditional Disney look, as it were.
It's got this stylized look to it, but it's still recognizably like a Disney project,
mm-hmm.
and I think that works really well for this. It still fits the style of animation, and that makes all of the fourth wall breaking feel all the more unexpected.
Yeah.
What movie came before this one?
Animated Tarzan.
Tarzan.
Although Dinosaur, but that was a different...
Yeah. And Fantasia 2000. Three movies came out in 2000.
Right.
Fantasia 2000, Dinosaur, and then Emperor's New Groove.
Right.
Okay, so from... I think it started with Lion King until whatever movie came before this one. Let's say Tarzan, like as far as this string of...
Narrative features, yeah.
Right. Because they were new to digital coloring... Every feature was doing kind of this faux shading on everything that kind of seemed like a holdover from Roger Rabbit in a way. And that has its charms, but this movie completely did away with that. And it was something that I super appreciated at the time because I always thought it was kind of unnecessary, didn't add anything. It was just a look that I wasn't that into compared to not doing that.
There are a few cool shading effects here and there in this movie, but they're used sparsely.
There's one shot where Cusco is standing at the top of the little waterfall before he goes to try to be a real llama, which is a fantastic scene on its own. But just that one shot where the morning light is being affected by the way he is moving, that always, even from the first time I saw this movie, screamed tech demo to me. Like, I kind of wonder if there was some technology they were doing with this one shot in the movie that could easily be removed.
And I'm sure the decision to not do so many shading effects was probably also born out of necessity of just not having the time to do that because they'd already wasted so much time making a completely different movie.
I wish I could find out what the budget would be for just the Emperor's New Groove portion of this production, because how much did they spend on the animation that was actually used versus something else from this era? Because I bet you that it was cheaper, and it is no less effective.
Well, Wikipedia lists this film's budget as $100 million. I'm guessing a lot of that went towards Kingdom of the Sun shit.
Yeah.
Maybe half of that, maybe $50 million or so.
I wish we could go back to full 2D animated features like this, and every now and then one happens in other countries. I wish people would look at this as the kind of thing to aspire to, where it doesn't necessarily have to be the most expensive thing in the world to do a fully fleshed out 2D animated feature.
I feel like the 2011 Winnie the Pooh movie was also kinda that in a sense. It was Disney trying to make a modestly budgeted 2D animated film that focused on really good character animation without letting the budget balloon to unsustainable Treasure Planet levels.
I think they were intentionally trying to make it look as much like the version back in the 60s.
Right.
Keeping it simple was part of the design.
And then they released it opposite The Last Harry Potter. But we've talked about that. Anyway.
When Yzma is sitting in the throne, the peasant that is talking to Yzma, I kind of wonder if that is this movie's human version of Winnie the Pooh, because no other character has an eye theory like that, and his voice sounds like Winnie the Pooh. And I'm just thinking about all of the times when I've been tasked with designing, we just need a generic dude for this one scene. It's like, generic dude is so boring. It's like, okay, he's Winnie the Pooh, but he's a human. That is so much easier to design than just dude.
Well, considering that we have the voice of Piglet in this movie, I guess that makes sense.
Yeah, the voice of Piglet is the old man who gets thrown out the window. And by the way, when that old man was in Kronk's New Groove, I do believe that was John Fiedler's last role in anything before he passed away.
I want to talk about the color design of this movie a little bit. Because this is one of my favorite Disney movies for color design. There are a lot of really cool, saturated reds of various tone in there that really popped when I went to see this in the theaters, and then when I got the VHS and watched it on my CRT TV, it didn't look quite so good. It was one notch better on DVD, and now both on Blu-ray and on HD streaming like we have now, it's like, oh, there it is. There's all that color I loved so well. Just opening with a gray tone background is kind of incredible, but it works super duper well. Besides just the mood, they made that chromatically work super nicely. It's very pleasing to the eye. They're very good at making the characters pop from the backgrounds in this movie. One that I wanted to particularly point out is when Yzma and Kronk have arrived at Pacha's house, And if you look at the way the wall is colored, it is colored in a very specific way. Pacha's wife has a very, very different color palette from Yzma, and it is set up in a way that they both manage to pop from their places in the background very carefully. One color moment that I'll never not think of when I think of this movie is the scene before the Panthers start chasing Cusco, and then the bright red as soon as they are chasing Cusco for maximum impact.
His narration that takes place over the first chunk of the movie, when is that happening?
When did he sit down and record that?
Well, he straight up interrupts his own narration and tells it to fuck off.
I think it's just in his head, and he's just kind of recounting it and realizing, like, oh, no, wait, I'm the asshole. Shut up, me.
Yeah.
We gotta stop.
And the scene where he tells his narration to fuck off, it was probably intended as a laugh, but it actually is kind of affecting.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no, it's very affecting, yeah.
It's this literalization of someone just telling themselves to get over themselves. That's another, I think, crucial step in actually making us kind of sort of empathize with this fucking jerk.
There's a thing on Reddit. I don't really use Reddit, but I know there's a thing on there.
AITA, yeah, am I the asshole?
It would be so great if somebody just went on there, typed up the whole story of Emperor's New Groove, asking am I the asshole, up to that point, and just see if anybody picks up on it.
You know, the use of narration in general in this movie is kind of interesting, because in movies, 99 times out of 100, narration is a cop-out. There are exceptions occasionally. Goodfellas and Shawshank are the two big examples that leap to mind of movies where you wouldn't want them without the narration, but most of the time it's a cop-out choice because something went wrong in production and post-production, and they had to cover some shit up, and they couldn't afford to go back and reshoot, so it's just add some narration explaining something. That happened with Dune, for example.
Or the entirety of Walking with Dinosaurs.
And technically, this movie is no exception, because in animation, the production is pretty much all post-production. For example, the scene with the brides towards the beginning, which really doesn't go anywhere. I mean, it establishes Cusco's character a lot more, as even more of an abrasive jerk than you thought. But the scene does kind of abruptly end, and then Cusco's narration just says, oh, are you still wondering about that llama?
We got 2 weeks to get this movie done. Go. So what happens? This happens, and then he'll say, oh, now this. And then we go over there. Okay, now go.
I mean, it's like you said of how this movie has no fat in it. I get the feeling that if scenes were eventually going to have fat, they just cut them off at the pass like that, like with the bride scene.
Which is exactly the thing to do.
Yeah.
All seven of those brides look exactly the same.
Oh, yeah.
Different hair.
Yep. Different hair, but they all look the same. And he's just like, yikes.
He basically swipes left on all of them right to their faces.
Here's seven perfectly fine, normal-looking women, and he's just going to insult them all. Is that the best you've got? It's like, what?
And it has nothing to do with the rest of the plot. They could have cut it out of the movie entirely, but they kept it in because it is a good character moment for Cusco. Along with throwing that old guy out the window for throwing off his groove, it's another example of him just being a horrible person for no good reason. And I think the decision to make all the women identical was probably just them saying, we don't have time to design seven different women. Just make them all clones of each other. But also, it helps the joke.
Yeah.
Again, it takes really good instincts to do that in a movie like this when you don't have a lot of time and you've just got to fly by the seat of your pants and think of stuff that works in both regards.
It's knowing where to simplify and cut stuff out so that you have the currency later on to flesh something out and let it breathe. It's funnier if these women all look the same, and that takes us less time to design, so they all look the same.
It's one of those things you don't necessarily think about while watching a big budget Disney movie where it's like, what? All of this animation is good. It's where they creatively cut corners so that you don't notice, and sometimes it even helps.
This is one of those, we're going to make a pop culture reference, but at the same time, eat up a bunch of screen time during a song.
Riverdance?
Yeah.
Riverdance!
They copied and pasted the same background dancer like 17 times. Just had the sync slightly off so they don't look exactly perfect. And then just have Cusco grooving around there a little bit. It's like 17 seconds has gone by. What?
We've watched this movie a bunch of times, and for some reason this was the time where that Riverdance scene just flashed me back to 1997 or where it was just like when that one Riverdance commercial was on TV just over and over and over.
Experience this symphony of sight and sound, now available on home video.
Fucking obsessed with Riverdance. Why?
This is the Disney equivalent of the Macarena being in Shrek.
Yes!
Oh, God. And that's one of, by the way, only two pop culture references in the whole movie. The other was
lions, tigers, bears.
Oh, my.
And apparently that Wizard of Oz reference was specifically pitched by one of the executives, which meant they couldn't say no to it.
That's not a bad joke.
Not a terrible joke. Yeah, it's just they didn't want to make a pop culture heavy movie because they didn't want to be compared to Aladdin.
There's something that Kronk says that I never thought about before because it's just like a funny in-character thing. He says, "The real Cusco?" Yeah. And I never thought about it in depth before, but could that be alluding back to the now-gone Prince and the Pauper plot?
I mean, it happens while she's smashing the Cusco head, so...
Maybe that is kind of a subtextual...
Maybe that's a little in-joke there. Or maybe not.
It wouldn't be the only in-joke this movie has.
Okay, I have to get back to the palace. Yzma's got that secret lab.
That was Disney throwing shade on the secret lab, an effects house turn animation house where they produce Dinosaur. And nothing else.
I forgot about that. When you get to the dining room scene, you see that little centerpiece guy. Mm-hmm. That was a side character that was supposed to be in Kingdom of the Sun.
The Waka guy, the one that was going to be Harvey Firestein, right?
Right.
I never noticed that. Wow. Speaking about the background decorations in the dining room scene.
I know where you're going with this.
Yeah, exactly. When Yzma's pouring what she thinks is poison into a nearby plant... As Cusco starts turning into a llama, so does the plant.
Yeah, they don't draw attention to it. You have to be watching for it.
Yeah, exactly. It's perfect. Why does Cusco briefly collapse? He collapses and then he wakes up like, okay, where were we? When I first saw it, my immediate impression was that he could tell they were trying to poison him and he was trying to catch them in the act. That's how it came across to me, but then he doesn't bring it up. And of course, later in the movie, he thinks they're coming to save him.
Well, think about your first drink versus whatever your current drink would be.
I don't drink, so.
You're saying he's a 17-year-old and he can't hold his liquor?
Yeah, I think it's approximately that.
Yeah, that could be, I guess.
I don't drink very much either, but figuratively, to those in the audience, your first drink versus whatever your current drink is.
He holds his liquor even worse than Doc Brown.
But not as bad as Roger Rabbit.
Now, about a year or so ago on this podcast, we covered the original Pinocchio, which of course has that horrifying donkey transformation scene. And I feel like Cusco's llama transformation scene is almost like a parody of that. It's the same kind of gradual transformation where first it's the ears, then it's the neck, then it's the face. But it's kind of like the Funhouse Mirror version of it where he's completely oblivious for the whole time and it's played for laughs instead of for scares. You know? The bit where Kronk is going, and Cusco's narration is going, oh, he's got his own theme music? You're one to fucking talk. You're not a whole theme song guy.
The narcissistic are not self-aware.
Oh, of course not. The bit where he's up against the wall and he's just kind of going, ah. If you've done any audio editing, it is abundantly obvious that you're just looping the same second so.
They probably could have varied that up a little bit, but probably thought correctly that most audiences wouldn't notice.
Yeah, exactly. I didn't notice the first time. It took until I started doing a little audio editing of my own for me to rewatch the movie and notice how obvious it was.
When Kronk falls down the stairs after losing Cusco in the sack, he goes, back, elbow, shoulders.
Yes. Yeah, I'd never noticed that before.
I had to turn on the subtitles to notice that. I never noticed it before. I know this wasn't Patrick Warburton's first ever voiceover role. Like, I think he'd already been cast as Joe in Family Guy by this point, and I believe the Buzz Lightyear series was the same year as this, but it feels like this was the moment where he became a voiceover staple. After this, we were just hearing his voice everywhere, especially in Disney movies. He was in Home on the Range, he was in Chicken Little, he was in The Wild.
He doesn't have a whole lot of range as far as what his voice can actually do.
No.
But he can do a lot of different attitudes with that voice.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And it's almost always funny.
The gym teacher in the first act of Meet the Robinsons, I was kind of amazed that wasn't Patrick Warburton's voice.
This project is unacceptable! Now give me 20 laps around the gym! Move it, move it, move it! Go, go, go!
And I feel like that was a conscious decision. All right, we cast Patrick Warburton in enough things. We don't want him to turn into the new Phil Harris.
Yeah.
Let's cast someone else as the gym teacher. But the character design just looks so much like he should have Patrick Warburton's voice that it feels weird that he doesn't.
Is it me? Or is Kronk the hunkiest Disney male in the history of Disney male human characters? Because even Hercules does not have the muscle mass of crime.
So by hunky, you're specifically referring to muscle mass here, and not necessarily attractiveness.
Gaston comes close.
Yeah.
Especially when he's roughly the size of a barge.
What about Wreck-It Ralph?
Well, I'm talking about that typical bodybuilder type physique.
He's the most triangular character.
Gotcha, gotcha.
Until Bill Cipher comes along.
He's even got weak ankles from carrying around all that muscle, I guess. The South American setting is so incidental to this movie. You could almost set it anywhere. Obviously, the South American setting was much more instrumental to the plot of Kingdom of the Sun. That whole story revolved around the Incan creation myth and their various mystical gods and demons and such.
I think that's what keeps it from aging poorly, the fact that it's mainly window dressing. I think that's what's kept it from being offensive.
It's the polar opposite of Pocahontas in that respect, because Pocahontas tried so hard to be culturally sensitive and not to offend anyone. And if you watch it today, it's really fucking cringy, whereas The Emperor's New Groove didn't try at all and seems to be fine.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm a white dude, third generation American. My family roots go back mostly to Eastern Europe, so I'm in no position to speak for any South Americans. But I've never once heard anyone call this movie offensive. I've never seen any think pieces about how problematic The Emperor's New Groove is. And speaking of South America, I remember the DVD, even though it didn't acknowledge the Kingdom of the Sun changeover, it did have a featurette about the research trip they took to, I think, Peru, back when they thought this was going to be Kingdom of the Sun. And I remember thinking, really? You went on a big expensive research trip for a movie that barely has anything to do with South America?
We had to look at a llama.
You may as well take a research trip to Russia to make the country bears.
For Mighty Magisaurs, I just played a bunch of Zelda.
The family in this movie, Pacha's family, is such a sweet family.
They really are.
Even with the like super annoying little kids. Oh, this is so lovely.
Considering this is pre Lilo and Stitch, those kids are great. They're perfect. Yeah, They're right on. It wasn't until Lilo came along that the bar was set for authentic kidness.
Absolutely.
In a movie. A
couple things I wanted to point out about Tifo. When he's referring to the height chart, did he say, "When you were me," to Pacha?
Yes.
That's adorable. I also wanted to point out, as the kids are doing like their bouncy walk away from him, Tipo falls completely flat on his face for exactly one frame.
Incidentally, Chicha, Pacha's wife, was voiced by Wendy Malick, who, of course, was David Spade's co-star on Just Shoot Me at the time.
Oh.
It's also worth pointing out, Chicha is the first pregnant woman seen in a Disney animated feature.
That's right. Because in Disney movies before this, pregnancy was depicted as either the fucking stork, or in Lady and the Tramp, they just cut to calendar pages going by. But you never actually saw the woman pregnant, and this is the first time you do. I don't know what the whole mystery was about the whole time. I mean, what kid doesn't know what a pregnant woman looks like? It was probably some Hays Code bullshit.
For Disney, which traditionally over its main animation features, most mothers are either dead or evil.
Right.
So it's like, yeah, go Chicha.
Chicha's neither.
Not only is she neither dead nor evil, but she's a really awesome mom character.
A whole ass family in a Disney movie. Can you believe it?
It's a Christmas miracle.
So where are Cusco's parents then?
I don't know if Emperor's New School ever revealed who Cusco's parents were or where they are.
I don't think they did.
Micah would know. Micah would know. Yeah. Hey folks, just interjecting here to say that shortly after we recorded this, I asked Micah that question, and we never find out what happened to Cusco's mom, but there's a flashback sequence in one episode where it's heavily implied that Cusco's dad was lost at sea. So basically, he suffered the same fate as Anna and Elsa's parents. Now, in that episode, we never get to see his dad's face. He's got his back to the camera, and we only hear his voice. And the crazy thing is, he's voiced by Maurice LaMarche, who also went on to voice Anna and Elsa's dad. And what makes it even more perfect to the Emperor's New Grooviverse is it's specifically Maurice LaMarche doing his Shatner impression.
Yzma, I'm going on a long, long journey. If something should happen to me, will you promise to look after little Cusco and not try to take over the Empire?
Why, of course.
Fascinating, isn't it? And now, back to the podcast. I love the cartoon logic that the squirrel suddenly has a balloon and the psychotic look on his face when he's about to pop it.
I love that this movie is unafraid to do stuff like that when it is pertinent.
The squirrel pops the balloon and nothing happens. It doesn't wake the jaguars up. But then Cusco says, ha, and that does wake them up. This is the smallest nitpick, but I wouldn't have had Cusco realize what he did and cover his mouth. I think it would have been funnier if he'd remained oblivious until the jaguars all actually woke up.
Mm.
Which is a great quick animation transition, the way they did that, but I feel like Cusco covering up his mouth diminish the joke just a little, but that's one of my only nitpicks about the whole movie.
Yeah.
Another minor nitpick, this movie has a little too much gay panic for my liking.
Yeah, I can see that. Somebody pointed that out once and I get it.
The kissing the llama scene and then the bit where they hug each other at the end but then pull away, kind of a no homo moment. I think Disney had yet to realize that gay people were their biggest and most loyal audience. So you get stuff like that.
Things made in the 90s.
Yay!
The mouth-to-mouth scene. I mean, it is a llama. It's not
Yeah, I mean, there is that, definitely. So it's bestiality, technically.
I also don't want to live in a world where that guy in the diner is not checking out Lady Cusco's ass.
I love that song. Hey, man. Nice.
We gotta talk about that diner scene.
Yep.
Because that is pure Looney Tunes right there. That is straight up Chuck Jones.
Even just starting with that Bob's Big Boy sign.
If this movie wasn't made the way it was and instead was one of those it's a Looney 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 Bugs Bunny movie type
sure,
of thing.
Sure.
This diner scene was its own 7-minute short.
Oh yeah. The diner scene would have been its own short, and then right after it, Bugs Bunny's voice would have sounded a little different because Mel Blanc would have aged 30 years, but anyway.
Hey, how about a side of potatoes, my buddy?
You got it. We want cheese on those potatoes.
Thank you, Kronk. Cheddar will be fine.
Cheddar spuds coming up.
Spuds yes, cheese no.
Hold the cheese.
No, I want the cheese.
Cheese it is.
Cheese me no likey.
Cheese out.
Cheese in.
That's like on the level of high British farce. It is so perfect.
And I love the happy birthday thing with the intentionally stupid giant sombrero.
That sombrero is the closest that movie ever comes to being racist at all.
Yeah.
Because that does seem like something that any restaurant, like TGI Fridays, would do that anywhere. Throw a sombrero on you.
I mean, that is multiple levels of colonialism right there. During the rapids and waterfall scene, I wonder if Mark Dindal was maniacally laughing, ha, now someone else has to draw all the bubbles.
This movie isn't without its influences. There are certain parts, particularly in the waterfall part, that feel like parts of Roger Rabbit Trail Mix-Up.
Trail Mix-Up, or maybe a little goofy movie.
Oh, yeah.
Waterfall! Waterfall!
What is it with waterfalls and cult classic Disney movies?
They're dramatic.
Look, we got a bubble guy on retainer. We need to use that bubble guy.
I really like the pacing of this movie. It could be easy for a movie like this to be too manic for one to be able to follow it or remain interested in it. I like the couple of awkward small talk scenes because it really helped that along, both while Kronk is away tending to the spinach puffs, and then the one where Cusco kind of wants to fake apologize.
Feels like wool.
Yeah.
Alpaca?
Oh, yeah, it is.
Oh, yeah, I thought so. It's nice.
My wife made it.
Oh, she knits?
Crochets.
Crochets, nice.
I love that when Yzma and Kronk are at Pacha's house, half the time the jump rope isn't attached to anything.
Yes.
One end isn't connected to anything at all. And it's going by so fast that we just don't care.
Did this movie kind of sort of rip off a joke from Family Guy? Because the where's the other guy bit with the shoulder angel is remarkably similar to a joke in the Family Guy pilot. And based on the respective timelines of when that pilot aired and when I know they were rewriting this movie, I feel like this movie might have straight up ripped off Family Guy. I don't know.
I don't remember that scene, so I can't speak to it.
Instead of the angel showing up late in like a hair salon chair, it cut to the angel stuck in traffic.
Hey, where's the other guy? Come on, you bastard, I'm late for work!
By the way, all that stuff with the guards turning into the cow and the octopus and the orangutan and shit, they actually talked on the commentary about how they would often assign scenes to animators without giving them the context. And the animators would be like, so Cusco's a turtle and they're being chased by an octopus with... All right, fine. This production's fucked up anyway. Who cares?
I thought that the animator casting was really good in this movie.
Mm.
On a lot of features, losing Andreas Deja would be a real hit, but Dale Baer really stepped up to play it with Yzma.
Much as I love Andreas Deja, he's one of the greatest animation talents to ever put pencil to paper, I don't see him nailing the comic energy of Yzma quite to the degree this movie does. I think it was a good decision of his to go be the supervising animator on Lilo instead. Dale Baer just fucking nails it.
But I also particularly wanted to shine a spotlight on Bruce Smith being the lead for Pacha.
Yes.
Because Pacha, if you really think about it, has to have the most range in this movie between serious and heartwarming scenes and then flat out comic sensibility.
Crazy diner slapstick.
Looking at Bruce Smith's body of work, it requires a guy with his kind of range to make this character work, and he really sold it. I highly recommend going on Twitter, not full stop, because I normally don't highly recommend going on Twitter.
Right, but right.
I recommend going on Twitter and checking out Bruce Smith's account, because he is taken to posting development artwork for things that never went anywhere.
Oh, man.
Like, he's been posting this thing with a bull that I kind of wonder if it might have been something that was between Sweating Bullets and Home on the Range.
Hmm.
He hasn't put a name on it. Maybe it's development for Ferdinand or something.
Maybe, yeah.
And he also posted a number of really funny drawings when Warner's asked him to try to pitch something with one of their properties, and he chose Screwball Squirrel.
Ah!
So those are very much worth checking out.
The fucking nostril jokes with the temple at the end are so stupid, they're brilliant.
We're doing this in Act 3?
First of all, the water pouring out, looking like snot, and then, of course, Yzma coming out, holding that thing, looking like a booger. It's pure, puerile, grade school shit, but it works, goddammit.
At this point in the movie, they've earned it and
absolutely
pointed out that, no, this is the movie where we do this.
Yzma turning into a kitten, that has layers. Because number one, it's a Catwoman reference. But also, how many Disney movies have ended with the villain turning into this giant, unstoppable monster? So this was a neat inversion of that. Yzma Kitty saying all that diabolical shit in the cute little kitten voice.
And once I turn back into my beautiful self, I'm going to kill you!
I'm pretty sure that was the inspiration for Alpha in Up.
Yeah, I can see that.
I'm ascent, my compadres, and you too shall have much rewarding from Master for the toil factor you wage.
I love the sincerity through insincerity of the end beat where he goes, "You lied to me. You said the hills sing. I didn't hear any singing." It's Cusco doing a nice thing, but he's still got to cloak it in dickishness just to keep up appearances. Pacha sees right through it, and Cusco knows Pacha sees right through it, so it ultimately all works out.
You know, this is something I was noticing last time I watched Cats Don't Dance, which was relatively recently. Mm-hmm. It's very clearly made by the same people in the way it is cartoony.
Right.
But one thing that's completely different is that Cats Don't Dance has no sarcasm. And Emperor's New Groove is almost entirely sarcasm.
To the point where the whole movie, the first time you watch Emperor's New Groove, it's funny and you're enjoying it, but you're also kind of dreading that by the end, there's going to be some big heartwarming moment where Cusco realizes, oh, I shouldn't have been so mean. And in that last scene, after the last scene with John Fiedler, you're just kind of bracing for it. It's like, all right, here's the cringy fucking heartwarming moment. And instead, they do this brilliant sincerity through insincerity.
Figured out a way to do the sincere moment without taking away the character.
Right.
There's so many movies where it's like, oh, it's a crazy, wacky character. But now it is time for us to be serious and have the serious conversation.
All joking aside, you really ought to be yourself.
Here, even the serious conversation has a twinge of irony to it.
Yeah, the scene with the old man at the beginning of that scene is kind of a mirror of our 30 seconds of making you think this is a Disney movie from earlier.
Right.
There's a lot of clever setup and payoff to this movie that
really
isn't necessarily recognized on a first viewing.
The movie was originally going to end with Cusco building Cuscotopia on a different hill. And Sting actually sent a letter to the producers of the movie just saying, I really strongly object to this ending. Cusco shouldn't learn the lesson of, oh, I'll just build my gross theme park somewhere else. He should learn not to build his gross theme park.
I've been aware for a while now that my vision of the world and Disney's may be at odds. I can only be candid, but there's something intrinsically faulty with this film.
The filmmakers just immediately realize, no, Sting is right here. He shouldn't build the summer home at all.
The nearly naked man from Dune is right.
Yes.
It's actually super interesting that that wasn't the intended ending, considering how nicely Perfect World Begins and Ends with Us mirrors the
right.
Perfect World Begins and Ends with Me from the beginning.
I mean, Sting did write the song, so maybe that's what he intended. And he's like, no, they're fucking it up.
The song ends with us. He has to end up with them.
And of course, I love that the model for Cuscotopia has become a birdhouse. That's a nice little touch.
There's this little moment at the end there, and it really is very nice, where Pacha's wife hands him his own poncho.
Right.
And he gives
her
a hug. And it's such a sweet moment. It's like, oh, this guy never really had a family.
The screenwriter of this movie, David Reynolds, was actually hired on while this was still Kingdom of the Sun to be the primary screenwriter. And they kept him on to turn it into Emperor's New Groove. He's a fantastic talent. He actually got his start writing for the first season of Conan in like 93, 94. He's in that kind of Robert Smigel school. He even briefly wrote for SNL and TV Funhouse. And he also wrote all the host segments in Fantasia 2000, so we have him to blame for that. And he co-wrote the screenplay for Finding Nemo, which got him an Oscar nomination.
Wow.
But earlier this year, Vulture did an oral history on The Emperor's New Groove, in which Reynolds says, technically, he didn't finish this screenplay until after the movie was in theaters.
I read this, yeah.
Animation being animation, the animators were going off storyboards instead of directly from any script, and the production was so fucking rushed and so grab-bag, just changing shit on the fly, he never actually had time to compile a proper script out of all the various unbound pages that formed the scenes from the movie. And when Disney Archives eventually came around asking for the final script just for record-keeping purposes, this is Reynolds' exact quote, "We had a couple interns just take all the pages and put them into a document, and then they wrote interstitials and they slapped my name on it. This is the honest-to-God truth. The first and only draft of The Emperor's New Groove was handed in 2 weeks after the movie was in theaters."
Amazing.
Which would have also been right around the time it left theaters.
Actually, I was tracking it at the time because I was really rooting for this movie. Mm. If I went five times, it must have been there at least 5 weeks.
Sure, sure.
But it actually grossed more the second week than the first week.
Did it? Wow, that does not happen anymore.
Yeah, that is not usual. So it was a sleeper, but I think word of mouth must have been at least good enough for that to happen.
So anyway, I do believe the time has come to answer that question that has baffled mankind and llamakind through the ages, namely, what's the attraction? So, The Emperor's New Groove has never had that much of a park presence, although I do know when DCA first opened, just a couple of months after Emperor's New Groove came out, there were walk-around characters of Cusco as a llama and Kronk and Yzma. You can see them briefly in the sweat box. They are hideous, and that's why they did not last long. And at the Disney Animation building at DCA, in the central atrium where they showed clips of all their animated classics, for about a decade there was a clip of Emperor's New Groove in there, but then they got rid of it. But now that people are going to catch on to what a great cult movie this is, and Emperor's New Groove is going to be the most watched title on all of Disney+, how is Disney going to work the Emperor's New Groove into the parks? Kyle.
It's a feature where you can learn basic squirrel language from Kronk, speaking squirrel with Kronk, but the entire thing really only exists so it can end with the line, "You are now speaking pigeon squirrel."
Lindsay.
You can go to that Bob's Big Boy diner and you can order the steaming pill bug. And if you want, you can go into the back and give your order to not the actual chef because people are trying to do their jobs, but a face version of the chef a la Flo's Diner in Cars Land. It's the Emperor's New Groove diner.
Luke.
I've seen the pictures online of the walk-around characters with the full head masks and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. Here's what they're going to do. And I truly, seriously, for serious, want this to happen. Wherever they have, not the meet and greet for Mickey Mouse or all the main stars, some of the other characters, or probably even better, wherever the princesses are. Oh, come in here and there's Belle and then there's Ariel and then there's Cinderella or whatever. Mm-hmm. So wherever they're all hanging out, all of a sudden out from somewhere comes a cart being pulled by a face actor as Kronk, pulling it all the way out, sets it up, makes an announcement and suddenly pulls a lever and then and it's the big Cusco thing, and Cusco is inside there. All right, everybody, step up and get your picture with a real star. Hey, come see the one and only Emperor Cusco and have face actors playing Cusco, Kronk, Yzma, and probably also Pacha, so that suddenly it's the big meet and greet with those characters. And the whole point of doing it this way is that Cusco is so egotistical that he's going to show up and squat in front of where the princesses are. Oh, that's a princess? Well, I'm an emperor.
If this setup led to me getting to see Cusco have an argument with Elsa, I would pay a separate ticket fee.
Well, Cusco is the best Disney princess. Unfortunately, you're all wrong.
What?
Nobody picked the obvious choice, because I'm guessing everyone thought someone else would pick the obvious choice.
Yeah.
The ride into Yzma's secret lab. Just build that ride. They make a theme park joke in the movie.
Please remain seated and keep your arms and legs in at all times.
And then the kids land in the secret lab and just turn each other into animals.
But then, just as they're building it, Sting sends a letter saying, please don't build the roller coaster thing. And they realize, oh, that guy's right, and they demolish all the parks. So, final verdict, folks. I probably don't even need to ask, but is The Emperor's New Groove a Disney Plus or a Disney Minus? Luke, it's your guest choice, so I'm guessing...
It's Disney Plus! As I said before, I'd have to rewatch Aladdin and give it a long, hard think, but my favorite Walt Disney Animation Studios feature film of all time is either this or Aladdin. Disney Plus.
Lindsay!
Disney Plus.
Kyle?
I know you don't like fence sitters on this show, so I'm going to go the opposite direction of that. Disney Double Plus!
Woo!
Well, it is unanimous. Emperor's New Groove is one of the biggest Disney pluses.
Yes,
I'm tempted to even call it the best movie we've ever covered on this podcast, but this podcast has also covered The Great Muppet Caper. So at the very least, it's like a toss-up between those two, because those are just both perfect comedies, in my opinion.
Yes.
What else can you say about it? It's The Emperor's New Groove. Go watch it if you haven't seen it already. It's fucking brilliant.
Truly.
Who's got stuff to plug?
Go watch season 2 of Solo. Opposites, the show that I devote my entire existence to at this point.
You lead character designer, you.
Now on Hulu. It's technically owned by Disney, but they're not going to put it on Disney Plus.
Unless you're in another country, in which case they did.
They did.
Yeah, under Star. If the whole Star thing ever comes to America, I'm probably going to just ignore it. Or maybe some theme month I'll do like Star Month.
You're probably going to get into a big Twitter argument about it, hence it will be the Star Wars.
Around Halloween, you could do an all Hulu thing, just a Hulu-ween.
Ooh, I don't hate that idea.
I have a brand new album up called Fidelity at tvskyle.bandcamp.com. I hate Twitter, but that's the best place to follow me, unfortunately, as far as posting artwork goes. So go to at tvskyle, T-V-S-K-Y-L-E in most places. You can also check me out on Instagram. I pretty much post all the same stuff there. It's just square there.
Are you in need of some action and adventure? Come on down to the Cave of Stuff in Riboflavin. We have all kinds of things that people who enjoy The Emperor's New Groove would like. Hey, look, this week our theme is the jungle. Here comes a vicious panther. Hey, Lady Hiss, you're the panther. Go.
Oh, roar. Hiff. No, wait. Roar.
They're jaguars in the movie, not panthers.
Grump, we ordered the wrong animal. I'm sorry.
How come you're always trying to make me improv? Yes, and you're gonna do it right this time.
What, am I just supposed to continue plugging MarsCon until I die or something? Ugh.
I mean, FumpFest is coming up.
FumpFest? You mean the event happening this August in Chicago, Illinois, featuring the 50th anniversary celebration of the Dr. Demento show with Dr. Demento himself?
Well, that's not till August, so...
Buy your theoretical tickets now.
Fortunately, time is linear, so people will hear this, and it will be true as time continues.
Linear. It's linear. The encyclopedia.
FumpFest.com.
Linear, the time that we're stuck in.
And as always, you can follow me on Twitter at Tony Goldmark. You can also follow this show on Twitter at EFVD Podcast. Twitter sucks, but it's what we got. It's Twitter's world. We're just living in it. I've also got a Facebook fan group you can join called Some Jerk with a Fan Club. And I've got a YouTube channel, youtube.com/Tony Goldmark, where you can find all 3 seasons of my web series, Some Jerk with a Camera, along with a bunch of other videos about movies and theme parks, and even a few scant episodes of this very podcast. You can find every episode of this podcast at pipedreampodcast.com, as well as all the usual outlets like Spotify, Audible, Apple Podcasts, and Google Play. If you like what you've been hearing and you'd like to help us out, please subscribe, please leave a review, please give us 5 stars. All that stuff helps us get discovered by the almighty algorithm. If you'd like to help us out even more, you can donate to my Patreon. Patreon.com/Tony Goldmark, where if you pledge any amount, even the bare minimum of $1 a month, you get to hear episodes of this podcast one day early. Special thanks to all my patrons. You don't know how much it means to me, especially in these financially uncertain times. And also, once again, a very special thanks to you, Luke Ski, for choosing The Emperor's New Groove as your guest choice.
No problem. And just for good measure, why don't you plug Micah's podcast one more time?
Yes, Micah Hirsch, creator of the YouTube animated series Podcasts United, also has his own podcast all about The Emperor's New Groove, where he covers everything related to The Emperor's New Groove, including but not limited to the movie, the straight-to-DVD sequel, the PlayStation video game, the documentary about the movie that only got released as a bootleg, every last episode of The Emperor's Emperor's New School animated series. He has interviewed people involved in the franchise, including animator Tony Bancroft and voice actor Bob Bergen, and he even did an April Fool's Day episode on the road to El Dorado, folks. That's the Emperor's New podcast, hosted by Micah Hirsch. Go check it out. We are finally back to feeding the entire master list of Disney Plus titles into the randomizer to pick next week's topic, and joining me now is one of my guests on next week's episode, Mr. Tim Crist. How you doing, Tim?
I am well, and yourself?
Doing quite transplendently, thank you.
Those are words.
Are you ready to read off the randomizer's pick for next week?
Sure.
Okay, Smart House, initiate random shuffle mode, please.
Initiating random shuffle mode.
Make a selection.
And the winner is...
Spider-Man series, 1981.
The Spider-Man 1981 series.
Oh my god, I remember that.
Let's see how many episodes there are of that, because we're going to be picking an episode at random. 26 episodes, so Tim, if you could do me a favor, open a new tab and Google random number generator.
Can you say Google again? I like the way you say Google.
Google.
Thank you.
And plug in 1 through 26 and see what it gets you.
Okay, you're not going to like this.
I'm not?
You're not.
What?
It's 18.
18. Why wouldn't I like that?
I don't know. I thought you didn't like even numbers.
The episode is called The Capture of Captain America. Join us next week on Escape from Walt Disney when we will cover the 1981 Spider-Man series, episode 18, The Capture of Captain America.
Come on home, where your video's playing. Good times are waiting, it's true. Come where your family is waiting for Walt Disney and you. Walt Disney and you. Walt Disney and you.
Well, you got me. By all accounts, it doesn't make sense.